Hello and welcome back to the Bible study course, the Gospel of St. Matthew. I am Der Narek, the pastor of St. Sarkis Church, and today we will go to our sixth session. We are halfway through, and we'll read chapters 11 and 12 from the Gospel of Matthew. So chapter 11 in the Gospel of Matthew is a hinge chapter that swings the storyline of the gospel into the next major phase. So it begins by addressing what Jesus' mighty words and deeds indicate about his identity. But also it shows a different response that that people have to the ministry of Jesus. Some believe that he is the Messiah, others sufficiently impressed to think that he is only a prophet, and others reject him. And the most disturbing of all, are the Pharisees who accuse him of working with Satan and his power, and they begin to plot his demise. So it starts from chapter 11, this section, and goes all the way to chapter 16. But today we will be covering chapters 11 and 12. Let's go to the text, and the rule is you pause the video, you read the text, you familiarize yourself with it, and then you play it again to hear the comments that I have to make. And today we start by something that I think you're accustomed to by now, and that's the opening verse. Now, when Jesus had finished instructing his 12 disciples, he went on from there to teach and proclaim his message in their cities. So this verse one is a structural indicator telling us that Matthew is making a transition from teaching back to the storyline. So the first thing that we read is about John the Baptist and him sending the disciples and asking the question to Jesus, are you the one who is to come, or are we to wait for another? So we know that John the Baptist was taken into custody. He was imprisoned. We read about this in Matthew chapter 4, verse 12. And it sounds like uncertainty took a hold of the imprisoned prophet. And that's why he is sending his disciples. This is what, we read. This is the classical explanation of this question that we read from most scholars. But one of my teachers, whom I respect very much, Zaire Sarpazan of blessed memory, he had a problem with this interpretation. And he would say, a prophet of the caliber of John, the one who said, this is the Lamb of God, who baptized Jesus, he could not have fallen into that state of despair. This was a message for the disciples of John to kind of know that they need to make the transition and become followers of Jesus. This was an occasion those who were around Jesus to kind of hear the public statement that he would make about himself. And that's why John prompted this question. So he would have hard time doubting that John was in a state of uncertainty and hopelessness. But let's focus on the response of Jesus. It sounds like Jesus is presenting basically a resume of his achievements. Go tell John what you see, the blind receive their sight, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the poor have good news brought to them. This is basically a summary of everything that Jesus was doing to this point. But when we make ourselves a little bit more familiar to the structure of the Bible, we see that we are reading this words of Jesus, and we have one eye on the Old Testament, and we're seeing the connection to the book of Isaiah. And it's in the book of Isaiah, basically chapters 26, 29, 35, and 61, we hear all these messages that have been prophesied about the Messiah. Throughout Isaiah, we find prophecies of the final age when God will bring healing into the hurting world of men and women. Among the events foreseen are the dead coming to life, the blind and the deaf seeing and hearing again, the lame leaping for joy, And the poor, hearing the glad tidings of the Lord, delivered by his anointed one. So this was a loud and a clear message, not only to John, but everyone who was hearing this message, that Jesus was indeed affirming his messianic identity and showing that, you know, whatever had been prophesied in the book of Isaiah has been coming into fruition through the mission of Jesus Christ. And he concludes by saying, "Blessed is anyone who takes no offense at me." This declaration is pronounced of the person who is not scandalized by Jesus. So everyone is encouraged to faith to see in the ministry of Jesus the works of the Messiah. As the disciples of John go away, now Jesus poses a series of questions to reveal the true identity of John, as he asks, what did he go into the wilderness to look at? A reed shaken by the wind? And many think that this refers to a people pleaser, to someone who is easily swayed by the opinions of others. And Jesus says, no, John was not a people's pleaser. And he was not someone who was dressed in soft robes. He was not someone who was pampered as a prince and, you know, in the royal courts. But what did you go to see? A prophet? And Jesus says, yes, I tell you, more than a prophet. This is now the testimony that Jesus gives about John, more than a prophet, because John, he himself not only prophesied of the coming of the Messiah, but was himself a fulfillment of the prophecy. We hear Jesus in this section, in the middle section of the slide, quoting the scriptures himself to refer to John and the prophecies that have been told about John in the Old Testament. And this one verse that has two lines here, the first line comes from the book of Exodus and the second part comes from the book of Malachi in the Old Testament. And this shows, you know, the knowledge of Jesus of the Old Testament, or the scripture, I should say. And then the second part of the slide is, you know, very difficult for us to understand. On one hand, he is praising John the Baptist. Among those born of woman, no one has arisen greater than John the Baptist. So this is a praise for the role of John the Baptist. Yet the least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. This is, I think, a hyperbole to emphasize that each and every one of us have that capacity to become great in the kingdom of heaven. Now, verses 12 through 15, this is the part where, you know, we generally struggle to understand because this is not clear. Probably, Jesus is telling us that with John the Baptist and his mission, there was a major turn of events. Everything that have been prophesized in the Old Testament, they start unfolding, and it's the Messiah and the everything new that he brings. And he also refers to John the Baptist as the Elijah, not the incarnation or the reincarnation of Elijah. Elijah was not, you know, in some weird way coming back through John the Baptist, but this was a reference that John had that same prophetic power that Elijah had. Now, in this segment, Jesus speaks about the failure of Israel, who, as a whole, they failed to respond to John and Jesus and their message of repentance. Not too many people took that message of repentance to heart. So Jesus asks this question, but to what will I compare this generation? Okay, when we read this word generation, we think that he is addressing the people who were alive at that time. But when we go and, you know, familiarize ourselves with this word in the context, in the biblical context, then what comes to our mind is the unfaithful generation. And this is something that we find it repeatedly in the Old Testament. And I'm going to give two examples. One unfaithful generation or wicked generation comes from Noah's day. And the other is the people at the time of Exodus who were denied entrance to the promised land. So Jesus is comparing people who are failing to receive the message of repentance to those wicked generations. Verse 17, we played the flute for you and you did not dance, we wailed and you did not mourn. Now this is a little difficult to understand, but we need to kind of learn about the culture of the day. So this comes from traditions of villages in Palestine, and according to customs among children, boys invited their companions, their friends, to dance at weddings and sing and dance, and girls to sing laments at funerals, and they would invite their friends to mourn. So there's a message of joy and a message of mourning here. And when we look at it from that perspective, then we can understand where is this going to. We know that Jesus refers to himself as the bridegroom. So the message that he brings is the message of is a festive message, is a message of joy, versus the message that John the Baptist brought. It was more, you know, it came from his ascetic life, and it was more somber, you know, and people did not respond to any message. They spoke about John and his little eccentric, maybe, practices of eating wild food that was in the desert. And they said, oh, this guy has a demon. But the Son of Man, Jesus, came and he lived a normal life. He was in the society. And they accused him of spending time with tax collectors and sinners and gluttony and drunkard. And basically, no matter how they approached, the wicked generation did not want to do anything with the wisdom of the Messiah or his forerunner. So the theme of unbelief continues in these verses. Jesus speaks about three towns, Chorazin, Bethsaida, and Capernaum. And these are towns and cities that have not repented. But these are towns that and places where Jesus had performed his miracles and spoken his word. So each had the privilege of witnessing the words and the deeds of the Messiah, and yet each refused to take his message to heart. Obviously, there were exceptions, but in general, they did not commit themselves to the new way of life that was demanded by the gospel. And the formula that Jesus uses here, woe to you, this is something that comes again from the prophets of Israel, of the Old Testament. And this is the way that they spoke of the Lord's judgment on sinners who refused to change their ways. And he compares those three cities, Galilean cities, to the two cities of Phoenicia, Tyre and Sidon. And basically those two cities on the Mediterranean were strongholds of basically Gentile life and corruption. And had Jesus performed his works, his messianic works in those cities would have received the message and they repented. And, you know, the signs of repentance, wearing sackcloth and putting ashes on their heads, this was a sign of repentance that, again, comes to us from the second book of Samuel. The fourth town that Jesus speaks about is Capernaum. This is the town that Jesus chose to be his new home in Galilee. And this city is headed for a similar and maybe worse humiliation, because Jesus compares that city to Sodom, and we know how God burnt the city of Sodom in the book of Genesis because of this sin and disbelief in God. So when we read these words of Jesus, we think that we're not affected by this, because the language is foreign and the context is different, and we have a different way of experiencing our Christian life. But there's a lesson to be learned here, and the basic lesson is: with great privilege comes great responsibility, because this Galilean cities that were denounced by Jesus were the cities where Jesus basically have performed a lot of miracles. He had spent a lot of time there. This was, this was his hometown. They witnessed all the great work of Jesus, and they chose not to believe. And our situation is similar, because although we don't have the personal presence, the physical presence of Jesus, but Jesus has entrusted us with the church. And in the church, we encounter Jesus in the Word, and we encounter Jesus in the sacraments. And if we do not change as we encounter Jesus, there will be a similar judgment that is awaiting for us. So the message is here for us is, in our pursuit of holiness, let us stop procrastinating. Let us embrace the message of the gospel, and let us embrace a life of change. As we move to verse 25 through verse 30, we are privileged here to listen to Jesus addressing his Father in a prayer. This is one of the rare opportunities that, as readers of the Gospel of Matthew, we encounter this, and we will find this also in his prayer, Jesus' prayer in the Garden of Gethsemane and also on the cross. This prayer is placed in the context of what we just spoke about his rejection by the Galilean towns. But pay attention that Jesus, although was rejected by many, but he is received by some. And that's a sufficient reason for him to praise God. And this is an important lesson for us to learn, especially us, the clergy, to praise God for even the little result that we see from the missionary work that we do. And listen to the way that Jesus addresses the Father. He says, "I thank you, Father." Probably the Aramaic way of saying this would have been Abba, and that implies the intimacy and the familiarity that a child would have with his parents. In this prayer, Jesus thanks God for the grace. And sometimes we think that this is a passive-aggressive way that Jesus is addressing the people who are rejecting him, especially the wise. But that's not the core of what's happening here. Yes, the wise and the intelligent, relying on their knowledge, they're not able to see Jesus. But the simple, those who are childlike, through that simplicity, they are able to receive the mystery of Jesus, and this is the grace of God that is given to us. In this prayer, Jesus also reveals more about his identity as the Son. As he says in verse 27, "All things have been handed over to me by the Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father." So Jesus is inviting his disciples, inviting his followers, as we continue to read the verse, "No one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him." He is inviting us to come to know God. But it is him who is revealing us about God. And his knowledge about God is different than the knowledge that we will have about God, because his knowledge comes from sharing the same divine nature of God the Father. So, we will become children of God, But our relationship is different than the relationship that Jesus, the Son of God, had with the Father. Jesus shifts from addressing the Father to addressing to his potential followers through this invitation, as he says, "Come to me, all that you are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest." So this is, an invitation that Jesus puts there as to have a personal and rewarding relationship with him. A personal and a rewarding relationship. I will give you rest. And then, take my yoke upon you. What is a yoke? A yoke is a curved beam that was laid across the back of the neck and the shoulders of a peasant that will help him to carry heavy burdens. Sometimes, I think in the Armenian version, we also understand it's the beam that is put on the back of the animal that is plowing the earth. So there's controversy here, because Jesus, on one hand, is calling people for rest from heavy burdens, but he's saying, "Take my yoke upon you." With this, we understand that Jesus is calling us for discipleship, and if you pay little details in the traditions of our church, if you look at the deacons, they're wearing a stole on their left shoulders. At the time of ordination, when the deacon is becoming a priest, the ordaining bishop takes that stole and puts it around the neck of the deacon as he calls the candidate to priesthood. That stole is a symbol of the yoke that is around his neck, around the shoulders, to be fully carrying and becoming a full disciple of Jesus Christ. So there is a burden, but this burden is light. In other words, becoming a disciple of Jesus is not something effortless, but it's not neither an exhausting burden, because it is done through the help of God. And there is that peace. Jesus is promising us rest. That's the spiritual rest. It is the inner peace that God gives to us. That peace that fills our lives, fills our hearts, and surpasses human understanding, as St. Paul says in his letter to the Philippians. We move to chapter 12, and in this chapter we see that the tension between Jesus and the Pharisees reach a new level. And as Jesus defends himself, he reveals more of his true identity. He reveals that he is greater than the prophet Jonah, King Solomon, and even the temple. So we start reading the first part here, chapter 12, verses 1 through 14. The first part is about the Sabbath. And in this story, we see Jesus and his disciples going through the grain fields, and the disciples are hungry. They're plucking heads of grain to eat, and the Pharisees have a problem with that. So, a little background here. Sabbath rest was one of the main identity makers, or markers, rather, for the Jews. And this was an expression of covenant loyalty. And this was not only a tradition that they had to follow, but in Jeremiah, when we go to the Old Testament, Jeremiah chapter 17 and verse 19 through 27, we see that the failure to observe the commandments concerning the Sabbath was one of the reasons that the Jews were taken to captivity by Babylon in 586 BC. So having this background information here makes us understand that observance of Sabbath was more than a private piety, but it was more of a national security. And the concern that the Pharisees have for the disciples of Jesus plucking the grain of and eat comes from this perspective. So the Pharisees bring this to Jesus' attention as they say, "Look, your disciples are doing what is not lawful on the Sabbath." And Jesus does not give an answer to them. It doesn't argue with the Pharisees over whether picking grain violates the Sabbath. Instead, But he raises the discussion to a different level. And there are two analogies that Jesus gives here. The first analogy is from the Old Testament, the story of David and his companions. So David was fleeing from King Saul, who was trying to kill him, along with his companions. And when he was hungry, he went to the temple, and in the temple there was bread, 12 loaves that was that would put in the sanctuary, and only priests had the authority to consume that bread. That bread was holy bread. But David and his men were granted a priestly privilege of eating the consecrated bread. So, in referring to this story, Jesus compares himself to David. So, this is an implicit messianic claim and affirms the disciples' participation in his messianic mission. The second analogy that Jesus gives here is what priests do, serving in the temple, performing various duties and actions in the temple through the burnt offerings or placing the bread in the sanctuary. All of this is physical work that they're doing, but none of it violates the Sabbath, because priests are exempt, or were exempt from that. And Jesus implicitly saying that his disciples enjoy freedom from Sabbath requirements because they participate in the mission of Jesus Christ. And he concludes by saying something greater than the temple is here. If the priests were exempt because they were participating in the life of the temple, the disciples of Jesus are exempt because they are participating in the mission and the message that Jesus Christ is bringing to this world. The temple was the center of the religious life, of the worship in the life of Israel. It was part of their national identity. And Jesus, speaking of himself, when he says something greater than the temple is here, he is implying that he himself is the new focal point of Israel's worship. And he concludes this part by saying, "But if you had known what this means, I desire mercy, not sacrifice, you would not have condemned the guiltless." This is something that comes from the Old Testament, and Jesus focuses on mercy and not sacrifice. God's mercy, and the expectation that God has from us to be merciful. And that this idea of mercy continues in the second part of the slide here, when Jesus heals the man with a withered hand. And again, he asks the Pharisees, is it lawful to cure a man on the Sabbath? And obviously, it's not allowed. And then he gives them an example. Suppose one of you has a sheep and it falls into a pit on the Sabbath. Will you not lay hold of it and lift it out? If you have the mercy to heal, save your sheep on the Sabbath, why can't you show mercy to a human being on the Sabbath? So basically, Jesus is not breaking the Sabbath, but he is rejecting the ways that the Pharisees were observing the Sabbath. And, you know, as he heals this person, the very last part on this slide, but the Pharisees went out and conspired against him how to destroy him. It feels like, you know, Jesus burnt their national flag or something. That was such a big insult for them that in their mind, he deserved the death penalty, how to destroy him. When Jesus realized the Pharisees' intention to destroy him, he withdrew from the place, a phrase that Matthew uses to describe Jesus removing himself from danger. Jesus eventually will challenge the Pharisees in regard to their murderous plot, as we will read in Matthew 23. At this point, however, he avoids a full-blown confrontation with them. With more to do in his public ministry, obviously, Jesus seeks to avoid unnecessary conflict. He does not want to attract the wrong kind of attention that might lead to his premature arrest and execution. But this is not like Jesus avoiding something that changing plans or whatever. Matthew comes to remind us that this avoidance was happening to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet Isaiah. And then he takes us to the prophet Isaiah, the servant song that comes from Isaiah chapter 42. And here is my servant whom I have chosen, my beloved with whom my soul is well pleased. Those verses we heard in the baptism, we'll hear eventually in the transfiguration. And Matthew quotes these verses of the prophecy to highlight how Lord's servant will accomplish his mission through humility. And eventually, I mean, when we go to the final parts of the quotation here, he will not break a bruised reed or quench smoldering wick until he brings justice to victory. So there's more for Jesus to accomplish before the point of his crucifixion comes. Matthew chapter 12, verse 22 and on, the Pharisees quickly continue their attack on Jesus' ministry. As we see, Jesus cures someone, a demoniac who is blind and mute, and the crowd who are witnessing this miracle, they are astounded by what Jesus does, and they're wondering, can this be Son of David? The expectations, the messianic expectations that they had, and the Pharisees also cannot deny that Christ has extraordinary power to overthrow the demons. However, they are convinced that Jesus is not from God. That, for that reason, the only other explanation that they have, they are convinced that Jesus is casting out demons, and that power and that ability is from Satan. And we see here Jesus addressing this issue directly by showing the absurdity of their charge, and he gives an analogy by, you know, using an example from a secular kingdom that it cannot stand if it's divided against itself. But the real explanation of the miracles and the exorcism Jesus declares is that Satan is being overpowered by someone who is much stronger than he. So this shows what Jesus is doing, and that is defeating Satan. And finally, Jesus speaks of the Pharisees committing the sin of blasphemy against the Spirit. The Pharisees' mistake, the divine Spirit who heals the sick, calms storms, gives sight to the blind, expels demons, and even forgives sins through Jesus' ministry for satanic power. Such a charge against God's Spirit will not be forgiven. So we need to be careful here. This does not mean that God does not want to forgive them, or neither it means that this is too great of a sin that Jesus cannot pardon. But, you know, it means that those who persist in their opposition to the Spirit in Christ close themselves off from the very instrument of salvation that Christ wants to offer them. It's like you're shutting your blinds, you're shutting your windows, and there's no way for that light to penetrate. It's a choice that you are making. They do not want, in this case the Pharisees, do not want to have anything to do with the Spirit who brings forgiveness, because they think it is satanic. Thus, Jesus concludes, whoever speaks against the Holy Spirit will not be forgiven, either in this age or the age to come. And in this second part of this section here, Jesus turns the table on his accusers and indicts the Pharisees on the very charges they brought against him. He says a tree is known by its fruit. On the one hand, this is a continuation of Jesus' defense. Only a good tree produces good fruit. Therefore, a good fruit of Jesus' exorcism must be from God. And on the other hand, this statement accuses Jesus' accusers. By speaking against the Holy Spirit, the Pharisees are being really bad fruit. Ironically, those who accuse Jesus of being in league with Satan are now revealed to be ones who are cooperating with Satan. And this is why Jesus uses those harsh words, as he called them, the Pharisees, brood of vipers. This is a word that indicates that the Pharisees were cooperating with Satan. And we move to the last part of today's study, and we see here the sign of Jonah. As the scribes and the Pharisees approach him, they call him teacher. You know, and we mentioned this before, that those who believe in Jesus, they call him Lord, but those who are doubting, they call him teacher, and they request a sign from him, as if all the signs that Jesus has been performing until now were not enough. And Jesus addresses them by calling unfaithful generation an evil and adulterous generation. And we started by giving explanation about the word generation or evil generation. I will not repeat that. And basically he reminds them of the story of Jonah, the sign of Jonah the prophet. And with that, Jesus foreshadows his death and resurrection with the analogy from Jonah's life, saying that his resurrection will be the ultimate sign that will demonstrate his divine authority. And continuing with the story of Jonah and Nineveh, how the people who received the message of Jonah, they basically accepted it. And those who received the wisdom of Solomon, they accepted it. Jesus comes here to say that there's someone greater than Jonah here, and there's someone greater than Solomon here. Basically, in his response, he continues to reveal about his divinity. And we go to this midsection of the slide, the return of the unclean spirit. This is connected to what we read before, the evil generation who refuses to accept Jesus indicates that his ministry has been breaking the devil's grip on Israel. But if people who are witnessing this ministry reject the one who is greater than Jonah and Solomon, they will end up in a condition worse than the first. But besides this explanation, I would like also to share my own personal spirituality that comes from this part, the midsection of the slide. And this is about the emptiness, the spiritual and emotional emptiness that we experience. And the way that I personally look at this is that, yes, we can have a lot of bad habits, and we cannot just get rid of the bad habits and create a vacuum in our lives. We need to replace those bad habits with good habits. And the ultimate way to look at it is to kind of understand who are we. And I'd like to remind you of the words of St. Paul that describes us, our bodies, as the temple of the Spirit. And it is natural for the Holy Spirit to dwell in us. So if the Holy Spirit is not in us, if the Holy Spirit is not in charge, that temple is not empty, is not vacant. It is dwelled by evil forces that they should not be there. So this story, although in the context of Matthew, is kind of part of a bigger picture, but I'd like to kind of look at it also from our own spirituality and the way we kind of get rid of bad habits and incorporate good habits in our lives. And the very last part is becoming part of Jesus' family. Jesus points to his disciples and he says, "Here are my mother and my brothers, For whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and sister and mother. Jesus is not disrespecting his mother. He is not disrespecting the brothers. And by the way, when we say brothers, we understand maybe there were some cousins or relatives, but Jesus did not have any immediate brothers. And the reason for that, when we read the Gospel of John, the crucifixion of Jesus, Jesus looked at John, his disciples, and said, "This is your mother." If he had other brothers, he wouldn't have said anything like that on the cross. But Jesus is giving us the honor to become part of this family. And the only criteria for us to receive that honor is to listen to to understand the will of God and to do the will of God in our lives. We will stop with this. I hope you enjoyed. This was another lengthy session. We will continue hopefully next week. Stay well, stay healthy. May God bless you all. This is Darren Nodick.